guess what? Yes, we are back once again. And also we are outside today. There it is, the view right now outside. And yes, I am standing in the garden as well. We are here together again. It is a lovely day here in England, and I hope where you are, everything is really nice as well. Welcome, this is English Addict, coming to you live from the birthplace of the English language, which just happens to be, oh my goodness, England. Here we go again. Hi everybody, this is Mr Duncan in England. How are you today? Are you okay? I hope so. Are you feeling happy today? I hope you are feeling good on this Sunday, wherever you happen to be watching at the moment in the world. I hope you are having a good day. Yes, it is a beautiful day. The birds are singing. The neighbours are all asleep in their beds. And there is the occasional helicopter flying over my head. So here we go then. For those who don't know who I am, my name is Duncan. I talk about the English language. You might say that I am a little bit of an English addict, to be honest with you. So I do love English. I've been teaching English, talking about English for many, many years. How long, Mr. Duncan, have you been teaching English on YouTube for? Nearly 15 years. Can you believe it? Almost 15 years I've been on YouTube doing this. So I couldn't resist coming outside today because it's a beautiful day. It really does feel as if summer is on the way. Springtime has arrived. You might notice behind me, over there, there are some lovely daffodils. Many of the daffodils, sadly, have now withered away. Wither. If something withers, it means it slowly fades or dies. So normally, after a flower has done its job, allowing the bees to come and take away the pollen, and at the same time fertilizing the plants as well, oh, so they can go to seed, the flower will then wither. So something slowly withers away. Sometimes I feel as if I might be withering away, to be honest with you. Thank you for joining me today. It's very nice of you to give up some of your valuable weekend. Here in the UK, by the way, lots of people out and about yesterday and also today, because lots of things have reopened. Many shops, many businesses are now open again. So people are really feeling as if they want to get out and about. In fact, we had one of our friends over the other night. We sat outside. We had a lovely time chatting and catching up in the garden. And yes, it was lovely. We had some delicious pizza as well. Very nice indeed. Hello to the live chat. Nice to see you back again. Yes, we have made it all the way to the end of yet another weekend. That's right. Yes, it's Sunday. I hope you are feeling good on this Sunday. Yes, the sun is out. The birds are singing all around me. Everything is quiet. Almost too quiet, to be honest. I keep expecting At any moment, all of my neighbours will come out and start making lots and lots of noise. But at the moment, it's very quiet. Yesterday, and I suppose I should mention, yesterday it was the funeral of Prince Philip. And lots of people were watching at home. I think many people decided yesterday to stay at home or maybe go out somewhere and then come back. Many people watching the funeral of the Duke of Edinburgh yesterday. I watched some of it. Mr. Steve watched a couple of hours of the funeral. But I also think yesterday a lot of people were not making any noise in the garden. So I think everyone yesterday in this country was distracted by the funeral taking place. And the only way you could see it was on the television. A very unusual situation. The funeral took place behind closed doors. However, the cameras were allowed to watch it. Did you see the funeral yesterday? I know it's not a very happy way of starting the live stream, but it did happen here. And it would appear that a lot of people yesterday were paying their respects by not going into the garden with their noisy lawnmowers. Talking of the lawn, Mr. Steve has been very busy in the garden. He has been busy once again. I saw him this morning. He was in the garden. And I think he is preparing to put some grass across the back. In fact, somewhere down there, if you can see behind me down there, somewhere down there, Mr. Steve has been working this morning, and I think he is preparing to put some grass seed, because he made such a good job of it last year when he did it at the back of the house. So I think Mr. Steve is going to be busy over the next couple of days. Certainly in the evenings he will be outside in the garden. Oh, hello to the live chat. Nice to see you here. I am now officially acknowledging your presence. Hello. Nice to see you here once more. Also, congratulations to Vitas. Oh, Vitas, guess what? Can't be bad. Fancy pants. You are first on today's live chat. Vitas, Vitas, you were first today. Very nice to see you here. We also have Olga. Hello, Olga. Nice to see you as well. Belarusia. Nice to see you here as well. Valentin. Edit or Edit. I have a feeling that I keep mispronouncing your name, for which I apologise. So Edit Goulet, hello to you as well. We also have Irene Maria. I'm saying hello to Maria right now. Ooh. We also have Mohsen. Hello, Mohsen. Hello, Palmyra. Alessandra. Nice to see you all today. It's a lovely day here. It is slowly getting warmer. I've noticed over the past couple of days the weather has slowly got warmer. So it's quite nice today. I think the temperature today is around 15 Celsius. We have lots of sunshine as well, and I am outside underneath my gazebo. A few people have asked, what does it look like? Can you please show us your gazebo? Well, I'm going to show you what I'm actually standing underneath right now. So here it is. So this is a photograph of where I am standing right now. And there it is. So you can see the gazebo. You can see all of the different types of equipment that I have to use. This is a very complicated thing, by the way. It isn't simple It takes a lot of work and effort to put a live stream together, especially when you are doing it outside. So there it is, the equipment that I'm using right now as I stand here in the garden. Nice to see you all here today. It is lovely. Thank you for giving up your time for me. Hello, also, can I say hello to Beatrice Nitram? Nitram is here watching from the Czech Republic. Hello, also, oh, can I say hello to Shireen Darfat? Hello, Shireen. Nice to see you here as well. Is it your first time? Please let me know. By the way, something I should mention, there is now an extra live stream in the week. On Wednesday from 2 p.m. UK time, every Wednesday and Sunday, I am here live on YouTube. So just in case you don't know, because some people haven't heard the news, for some people it might be good news, for others it might be bad news, I don't know. But yes, I am with you now twice a week, once again live on Wednesday and also on Sunday as well. You can catch me right here on YouTube. Hello to Margaret. Margaret Lopez. Nice to see you here as well. Intelligent. Hello to you, Lilia. Let us all give our favourite English teacher a well-deserved thumbs up. Very nice. If you like this, give me a thumbs up. Very nice. Thank you very much. Yes, Mr. Steve will be here soon. He will be back with us. Don't worry. I know on Wednesday we don't have him because he's busy working. However, today Steve will be here, right here under my gazebo, spending a little bit of time together. By the way, today we are looking at words and ways of expressing something that you might have heard from time to time, something that a person might say, something that a person might talk about, something that is a necessary evil. If something is a necessary evil, what does it mean? And you might hear this phrase used from time to time when people are debating the use of something. I knew someone would start their lawnmower. I knew someone was going to do it. And there it is. Yeah, great. So a necessary evil is something that you have. It is a thing that you have. But really, the thing itself is quite harmful. Maybe it causes damage. So we will be looking at that a little bit later on. Also, an event that occurred last night. Someone who lives not very far away from here had some very unusual things stolen from their garden. And here they are. The people who live not very far away from here, they are a family that live around this area. And last night, someone came and stole their lovely table and also their chairs as well. Now, I know what you are going to say, Mr. Duncan. Did they leave them outside? Well, yes, I suppose they did. So the table and also the chairs last night were stolen. So someone managed to get into someone's garden without making any noise, and they were able to steal these items. So just in case, can you please check now outside your house, in the street somewhere? Have you seen this table and these chairs? If you have, please let us know. Maybe they are being sold somewhere on eBay. Maybe. Which leads me to a very interesting question. What is the most unusual thing you've had stolen? Have you ever had anything stolen from you? Something that was yours, and then suddenly it disappeared. It vanished. It was stolen. I've had things stolen from me in the past. I suppose the most unusual thing I've had stolen was my dog. Although these days it has become more common for people to have their dogs stolen. Here in the UK, people have gone crazy about dogs. They love owning dogs. One of the things that is happening now, though, is people are now stealing other people's dogs. So that's what happened to me when I was living in China. Someone actually stole my little doggy. So that is a very unusual thing to have stolen. So what about you? Have you ever had anything stolen that was strange or unusual? Something that you wouldn't imagine anyone stealing? Please let me know on the live chat. Talking of which, yes, the live chat is now running. And yes, Valentin. Oh, hello, Valentin. Valentin says you might find those stolen items, the items that were stolen from someone's garden, a table and some chairs, you might find them being sold on the black market. Interesting. That is a very interesting phrase. You often use the phrase black market when we are talking about something that is being sold, but they don't want to draw too much attention to themselves. So the black market is where something is being sold, normally illegally. So maybe it is something that you shouldn't sell, like drugs perhaps, or something that has been copied, something that is counterfeit, it isn't genuine, or of course something that has been stolen as well. Yes, thank you very much. That's a great expression, by the way. We talk about things that are for sale on the black market. Although I don't know about you, but I'm always very suspicious of eBay. I don't know why. I've never bought anything from eBay, ever. And there is a reason for that. And the reason is I don't really trust it. I always think maybe the things that are for sale on eBay might be stolen, or maybe they are faulty and they don't work. So I always worry about buying things on eBay. I don't know why, but I've never bought anything on eBay, ever. I sometimes go on there and have a look at all of the things that are for sale, but I never buy anything. Thank you, Palmyra, for your lovely message. Isn't that lovely? Thank you very much. That is very kind of you. Congratulations, Mr. Duncan, for the opening of your bars and restaurants and shops. Yes, many businesses are now slowly going back to normal. However, of course, there have been many businesses that have sadly had to close permanently because of the lockdown, unfortunately. Hello to Shirley. Shirley, Germany, Successo Total. I love your name, by the way. Hello, my number one. You are the best. I love you. And that is Shirley from Egelbach in Germany. Hello to Germany. Nice to see you here as well. Lovely. Nitram. That is a very good question, Nitram. Is it still politically correct to say black market? As far as I'm concerned, yes, you can still use black market. So I know that there are many words that use the word black, or phrases that use the word black, that are seen as not politically correct. But as far as I'm concerned, as far as I can tell, I think you can still say black market. Something that is being sold illegally, or maybe something that has been stolen and is being sold in a place where stolen items can be bought. Intelligent says, the saddest thing I've ever had stolen is when I was 5. I had a toy cement mixer, so a little toy that looks like a cement mixer, which, by the way, is a very unusual toy. I've never seen one of those. It was stolen from me in the playground. Well, that's not very nice, is it? I hope you told the teacher about it. I hope you told the teacher. And that person got into trouble, I hope so. There is nothing worse than the feeling of having something stolen from you. I think it's the worst feeling in the world. The feeling of having something stolen, especially when the person comes into your house. Maybe a person breaks into your house at night and steals things. Not very nice at all. It can be very upsetting. Hello to Stephen Adu. Hello, Stephen. I have watched a lot of your videos, but this is the first time to watch you live. Thanks for your fascinating teaching. Thank you very much, Stephen Adu. It's your first time here on the live chat, so I will give you a round of applause. Very nice. Don't forget, at 3 o'clock UK time, we will have those super duper flags of the world, and in a few moments also Mr. Steve will be here as well. But now we are going to take a short break whilst Mr. Steve makes himself comfortable. He will be right here next to me in around about 7 minutes from now. We are going to take a look at one of my full English lessons. This is taken from Full English number 36. And then after this, yes, he is back by popular demand. Our very own April Fool, Mr. Steve, is on his way. Ahoy hoy! What a strange thing to say at the start of a new lesson. Well, it might seem strange now, but did you know that after Alexander Graham Bell invented the telephone, he thought that saying hello when answering a call would be confusing for the person at the other end of the line. So he suggested that people say ahoy hoy instead. That's a fact, and you can put that in your hat. Hi everyone, and welcome to another Full English lesson. Yes, we are all here together again to share our love of the English language. So without any more... hanging on the line, let's get on with today's Full English lesson, which will start around about... now! A man goes to the doctor. He says, doctor, doctor, I feel like a pair of curtains. And the doctor replies, oh, pull yourself together. There is nothing I enjoy more than having a good laugh. If I find something funny, then it is hard for me to hide my amusement. Something funny amuses me. The funny thing is
amusing. They say that laughter is the best medicine when you are feeling sad, and this might very well be true. However, saying something you find funny can sometimes get you into trouble. Sometimes making a joke about something can get you into hot water. There are many words relating to jokes and humour, such as comedy, which defines anything done for the amusement of others. A comedy act will perform something funny. Then there is clowning, or clowning around, which describes the act of not being serious. You are playing for laughs. You are clowning around. A carnival performer who acts in a ludicrous way for the amusement of an audience is a clown. We might describe a person who always acts the fool and never takes anything seriously as a clown. He always disrupts my lessons by acting the clown in class. We wasted a whole day clowning around with party balloons. Another word relating to humour is comedian, which is a person who tells amusing stories and jokes for a living. Then there is a comedienne, which is the term used to describe a female comedian. Although these days the word comedian is often used for both male and female comedy performers. A joke is a story with a humorous ending. The funny part of a joke is called the punchline or tagline. It is the climax of a joke or story. Another word that can be used to mean joke is gag. You tell a gag. You stand up and tell gags. A person who stands on a stage to tell jokes is called a stand-up comedian. They perform stand-up comedy. Their act is called a routine, which is a carefully rehearsed comedy performance. I saw one of the funniest comedy routines ever last night. I'm off to the comedy club tonight to see some new routines. If a group of people are performing a short funny play with a humorous story, then this is called a sketch. If someone is making a joke about a famous person or a well-known organisation, such as the government, then this is called satire, lampooning, spoofing, or sending up. A well-known celebrity or politician might be on the receiving end of a satirical sketch. The comedy performers are poking fun at the well-known person. To perform a humorous version of something serious can be described as a spoof. The movie This Is Spinal Tap is a spoof of the rock music industry. Then there is tongue-in-cheek humour, which makes fun of something in an ironic or insincere way. The thing being watched seems to have a serious tone, but it is not to be taken seriously. It is all done tongue in cheek. It would be fair to say that a joke which is funny to one person might not be funny to another. It might even be considered by some to be offensive. Each one of us has a slightly different feeling when we hear the same joke being performed. It all depends on what is being said and who is saying it. I can't believe you find Doug Stanhope funny. He is so rude. I don't understand why you dislike Doug Stanhope so much. He is hilarious. This is what we call our sense of humour. Some people will laugh at anything, whilst others will hardly ever laugh at all. It is yet another fascinating piece of the human emotion puzzle that makes us all the individuals we are. Do you have a good sense of humour? What makes you laugh? Do you know any good jokes? One of the most frustrating parts of living in this modern age must be the amount of information we are expected to read and absorb. To make matters worse, sometimes this information is written in such a confusing way that it becomes unintelligible. The words used are incomprehensible and perplexing. It is hard to grasp what is being explained to you. We call this type of information jargon. The word jargon means a specific type of terminology that relates to a certain subject. Some of the words used in one area of a particular subject can be described as jargon. I don't understand this letter I received from my lawyer. It's full of legal jargon. Don't try to blind me with your science jargon. Just give it to me straight. To follow a list of instructions that have been given to you might force you to learn some of the jargon. To master how to operate this device, I will need to learn some computer jargon. The jargon being read isn't fully understood. It is too esoteric. It relates to a specialist field. The thing being read is unintelligible. It is all gobbledygook. It makes no sense. As far as you can tell, it's just a load of mumbo-jumbo. A letter from your lawyer or doctor might contain lots of jargon. An advanced textbook on a particular subject might contain lots of confusing jargon. The operating instructions of a piece of technology will almost certainly contain lots of lovely technical jargon. We will often ask for the information to be simplified and explained in plain English that we can easily understand. Just give it to me straight, without all the jargon. Some might say that the one good thing about jargon is that it forces us to learn new things and absorb new information. This might be true. However, in this fast-paced age of new information appearing almost on a daily basis, it might be time to lessen the technical terms, cut down on the gobbledygook, lay off the confusing terminology, and ease off the use of jargon. Please.
And there it was, one of my full English lessons, and there are lots of full English lessons. In fact, there are lots of lessons of all shapes and sizes on my YouTube channel. Hello everyone, welcome to English Addict.
Hello, 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 Mr. Duncan. Hello, everyone.
Hello, Mr. Steve.
Why are you pointing at me? It's rude to point. It's okay. Didn't you know it was rude to point, Mr. Duncan?
Okay, well, I'm just showing you. There he is, Mr. Steve.
Do you like my rake?
What is that?
My rake. I've been raking over the ground.
Okay.
As opposed to raking over my shortcomings. I used a little... Is that an idiom, Mr. Duncan? I use an idiom there, to rake over something.
Well, to rake over means to try to obscure something.
Yes.
You try to hide something. You rake over. But this is a very useful thing if you want to make your ground level. So that's what Steve's doing at the moment. And I think you are preparing to plant some more grass.
Grass seed, because, or grass, I would say grass seed.
Okay.
You would say grass seed. We can pronounce it either way, but obviously the correct way is grass.
Okay. Okay, but I've forgotten what I was saying now.
I was preparing to get a lawn ready, wasn't I? I was planting seed.
That's what I was going to say. I was going to say that last year you did a brilliant job of laying some new lawn. Steve put some grass seed at the back of the house. So now you are going to do the same thing with a small part of the garden. You are going to add some grass to the front.
It's been a lot of effort, I can tell you, Mr. Duncan.
I know.
As usual, doing it all on my own.
Yes, as you keep telling me.
If you rake over something in your life, it means you're trying to cover it up.
Yes.
Maybe rake over your shortcomings in a job interview.
Okay.
Or something like that. I'll put this down, shall I? Because yes. It could damage some of Mr. Duncan's very fragile and valuable equipment.
It might actually damage some of Mr. Duncan.
And might damage some of your equipment as well. I'll get rid of it.
Okay.
I only bought that this week because I hadn't got a rake. Can you believe it? I've got lots of other garden tools, but I didn't have a rake.
Steve has everything else except for a rake, but now he has one.
Wonderful.
Very nice. The live chat is very busy, by the way, today.
Yes. Yes, it is. You are correct. Tachiavello says, those things are pretty useless and tiring. Well, they're certainly tiring, but I do need to level the ground, and I think it has helped me a bit. Otherwise, I'd have had to use my hands.
What I like, Steve, is over the past couple of days, because we've had a lot of sunshine and a lot of dry weather, apparently April is going to be the driest April, this April, the driest one ever, because we've hardly had any rain. And apparently between now and the end of April, there is going to be no rain here in England.
I'll have to get my hose out.
But what I was saying is the ground is so hard. Poor Mr. Steve, he was having to use a hammer.
A mallet.
A mallet to break the pieces of dirt because they were so hard. Because the ground around here is actually made of clay, so everything will go rock hard. It's really hard. So poor Steve was on the floor breaking the dirt because it was so hard and solid.
With a mallet, yes, it does. It goes like rock. Because we've got a high clay content. Judzika says that she has one of those to brush her long hair.
Okay.
So long. I would imagine Pedro probably has the same thing.
Yes.
Because Pedro's got very long hair. Maybe he has to use a rake.
Oh, by the way, Pedro, if you want to send some messages or photographs, my email address, I will put my email address on the screen because a lot of people are asking about... Here we go. So here is my email address. Stay in touch through email. And you can see the email address on your screen now. So if you want to send a message, maybe you want to say thank you, or maybe you want to send a nice photograph, perhaps of your pet or yourself. There is the address for your emails and all of your correspondence. Very nice.
Yes, and thank you, Pedro, for suggesting to everybody that they hit the like button. Because that will indeed help Mr. Duncan to get noticed all over the world.
Yes.
So thank you for that.
I don't know why YouTube doesn't like me anymore.
Probably because we keep criticising them on live, on air, on a Sunday.
Okay. you're talking in... very strange way today.
People are talking about things that they had that were stolen.
Yes, because I talked about it earlier, because someone who lives very close to us has had something stolen from them.
Really?
From their garden. Yes, here we go. So all of this, the table and also all of the chairs, were stolen from someone's garden. Right. I don't know how they... I want to know how they did it. Because obviously... it's in their garden, so perhaps they had to break into the garden and then carry all of that away in the night. So that happened last night.
What, in the place where we live, Mr. Duncan? Not in Much Wenlock?
Not quite Much Wenlock, but a place not very far away. So that led me to talk about things, or unusual things, that people have had stolen.
I wonder if they live near a main road.
I don't know.
Because I would think that it would be very easy, or much easier, to steal something from somebody's house if they live near a main road. Perhaps they had it on display and people could see it, and cars driving past, and somebody thought, well, I'll come back one night and I'll steal that. What horrible people, because I would imagine that looks like it's... very expensive. It looks like it's made of iron or cast iron?
Yes, I think so.
I would imagine that's a very expensive table and chairs.
Very expensive. And also someone somewhere will now be selling that. And I mention this also. I've never bought anything from eBay ever because I always think that the things for sale on there might be stolen. So I've never bought anything in my life. Valentin says, Mr. Duncan, maybe it was a white van. Well, maybe they used a white van to put the stolen goods inside.
I think they would have to because you couldn't get that. This must have been a planned theft.
I think so.
A planned theft. I would imagine it was on display and visible to drivers driving by. Or a neighbour has stolen it and sold it. Disgraceful.
Intelligent is here as well, Lilia.
Hello.
Nice to see you here as well today. Nice to see you. Here's an interesting phrase that we sometimes use in English. And you may have heard of this phrase as well, Mr. Steve. I'm putting it on the screen right now. There it is. Yes. Something that is described as a necessary evil. So when we look at that word, what we are actually saying is something that is needed, something that is needed maybe to perform a certain task or maybe a person, a thing that is needed but which may also cause harm. And I'm sure you can think of many things, and I'm sure you can as well, Steve, many things that we have or we need, however, they can also be harmful as well. For example, well, the thing might be an object, or it might also be a person.
So it's something that's done to you.
Yes.
Maybe.
Certain types of fuel. See, I know you're going to like this, Mr. Steve. Certain types of fuel, for example, coal and oil, and I suppose I should say petrol as well. Now, I know petrol comes from oil, so it's all the same thing.
Fossil fuels.
Yes. So you might say that fossil fuels, that's a good one, like coal and oil, they damage the environment. However, we need them as well. So you might describe those things as a necessary evil.
Yes, because without them, we couldn't function in a modern society. Obviously, that fossil fuels are going to be replaced probably largely in the future by, I don't know, 2050, something like that. Actually, I was fascinated to read the other week, Mr. Duncan, or this week, that in Scotland, for those of you that don't know, Scotland is north of the north UK, part of the UK, but far north. It's very windy, lots of sea, lots of waves. They're now making 95% of all their electricity from renewable sources.
So it's
the
amazing.
Wind, the wind, and also the sea as well with the waves. So I thought that was, and they're going to be 100%, I think, this year. And then they will be able to export their electricity to the rest of the UK. So yes, just shows you what you can do.
But I think Scotland is a very good example because they do have a lot of wind, because a lot of Scotland is open, and so it is open to the elements, and wind is a very common thing.
The North Sea is very windy. Of course, all that wind could be due to all the haggis that they eat.
Okay.
That was a joke.
Another necessary evil.
All right.
Weapons. Ooh. Now, I'm not saying that weapons are good. What I'm saying is they are sometimes a necessary evil, especially when we are using them for defense. So I'm not talking about attacking people. I'm talking about for defense. So you might say that there is a very good argument for having weapons if you want to use them for defense. So you might say that weapons, and we can all think of the weapons. We don't have to think too hard. Guns, maybe aircraft, drones, perhaps.
Nuclear submarines.
Yes.
They cost a lot of money, but if you want to feel safe in your beds at night, then you are quite prepared to let your government spend lots of your taxpayers' money on weapons for defence, which is a necessary evil. Yes, as you can hear, as soon as Mr Duncan comes outside, everybody starts up their various garden machinery.
It's always the same person as well.
Yes, it's that awful neighbour that we all hate.
Oh, OK. Sorry, Steve said that, by the way, not me. I didn't say that, Steve said that.
I didn't mention any names, so, Mr Duncan, no names.
OK, Steve, got to move on. So weapons might be something that we...
You're in a ratty mood today, Mr Duncan.
I'm not. I have a lot of things I want to do.
Faster then, get on with it.
Because we have 8 minutes before Flanks of the World. So it's all happening for a reason. Don't worry. Submarines, by the way. I've never been in a submarine, and guess what? I'm never going to.
Don't think many people have, to be fair. Don't think many people have been in a submarine.
Has anyone out there? Has anyone out there been in a submarine?
Might have been in a hot air balloon.
Okay.
But I don't know that you can get sort of, you know, rides in submarines, can you?
Can you?
Maybe you can. If you live near the coast.
Maybe you could build your own out of a bathtub.
Yes, please tell us if you've been in a submarine. we'd like to know. And have you seen all the creatures under the sea?
Yes. Maybe you live in one. Maybe you live in a submarine. Perhaps it's yellow.
I was going to say that.
So another necessary evil. Some people might say Mr. Steve. Some people might say Mr. Steve is a necessary evil, and you would be right.
Oh, but what about an operation? What about exploratory operations?
I suppose, yes, certain types of surgery.
Oh, I've thought of something. Having to have a COVID test.
Oh, yes.
Because that is very, very unpleasant, apparently, having to have those big things stuck up your nose and down the back of your throat.
Well, it's a swab.
A swab is the word I was looking for. Thank you, Mr. Duncan. So that's uncomfortable. It's not very nice. You could describe it as evil, but it's a necessary evil if you want to prevent the spread of infection.
Valentin says, do you think stealing your neighbour's lawnmower might be a necessary evil? I think so. Yes, we might have to go round tonight and steal her lawnmower.
Well, it's not hers.
Oh.
She has somebody to go round and do it for her.
Okay. How lazy.
I thought there was a giant bee in the background earlier, but I think it was a strimmer.
Okay.
Somebody's garden strimmer.
So a certain type of punishment.
Mr. Duncan, don't worry. Later on, I will get my revenge and have our lawnmower going. I'll have it going for about 2 hours.
Okay.
I will get our revenge.
Lovely. So maybe a type of punishment could also be a necessary evil. So locking people in prison, or maybe even punishing them physically in some way, maybe even executing people, you see, might be seen as a necessary evil, a way of getting people or encouraging people to obey the laws of the land. Here's another one, Steve. An environmentally damaging necessity. Can you think of what I'm talking about there?
An environmentally damaging necessity. Well, we've already talked about fossil fuels, so
yes.
It can't be that.
No.
Cars.
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 Possibly. And I'm not an expert on the environment, but I would say possibly the most damaging thing that exists is probably the motor car. I think so. And a good example, of course, is Beijing, where over the past 10 years, people have been buying not one or two cars, but millions of new cars have come on the road in Beijing. And now there is a lot of pollution caused by all of the traffic. So yes, you might say that you need your car, would you say? Do you think you need your car these days, even though most people are staying at home?
Well, I've only done about 30 miles a month in the last year, so I've hardly done any miles at all. In fact, I had to have a service on my car this week, even though I've only done about 1,500 miles.
Okay.
Say 2,000 kilometres in the last year due to the pandemic, it still had to have a service because you have to have one with my car every year, even if you've done no miles. I think that's probably the case with a lot of cars because you have to change the oil because the oil degrades.
Okay.
There's a good word, degrade, so it loses its quality over time. So that has to be replaced anyway. Okay. So it is in modern society a necessary evil, but something you to consider here, Mr. Duncan, are the container ships, cargo ships, merchant ships that sail around the world. I read this week that one of those, they burn the most polluting form of fossil fuel known to man. It's called bunker fuel.
Oh gosh.
And it's, I think it's basically just like diesel, but totally unrefined.
Oh dear.
So it's presumably because it's cheap. And one ship going across, I don't remember the distance,
okay,
is equivalent to 50,000 cars
just
worth
one
of pollution, just one container ship, because they emit the foulest polluting from
fumes.
Their fumes from their engines. But of course, because it's at sea, we can't breathe it in, but it's still going up into the atmosphere and causing global warming.
So yes, you think of motor cars, I suppose ships, aeroplanes. Yes, I suppose aeroplanes, another necessary evil. We like to travel, we like to go on holiday, visit our friends in Australia, and the only way of getting there is by aeroplane. So yes, all of those things might be described as necessary evils.
Yes, if you go on.
Okay.
What, you finished?
A person who is despised but is also useful. Maybe someone.
Who would that be then? Someone who's despised but is also useful. Who are you thinking about?
Anyone. So maybe a person at work, maybe a person who can help you with a task at work, but you don't really like them. Or maybe they are a sort of annoying.
Maybe your boss is a necessary evil.
Yes.
You have to have somebody who's in charge, a manager. But nobody particularly likes them. But then nobody wants to do their job either, because it's a difficult job managing people, and maybe nobody else wants to do it.
Yeah.
Somebody has to make the tough decisions in a business, and so maybe you could describe an unpleasant boss as a necessary evil.
Bruna Gorgi says, yes, I have been in a submarine in Genova. So there you see, one of our viewers has been in a submarine.
Yes, and so has somebody else, and I've missed who it was now.
Okay.
I think it was somebody else said they'd been in a submarine.
Okay.
I'll get to it in a minute.
Good.
Keep talking, Mr. Duncan.
Well, you've got 30 seconds.
Palmyra.
Palmyra
was in a submarine in Kaliningrad.
Interesting.
Very interesting, yes.
Yeah. So we are coming up to 3 o'clock. A bad habit might also be described as a necessary evil as well.
Yes.
So maybe something you keep doing, maybe alcohol, or maybe cigarettes, or maybe something illegal. Ooh, you might see it as a necessary evil. Guess what, Steve?
Is it Flags of the World?
We are now, well, in fact, it's just past 3 o'clock here in England. And yes, you know what's coming now. It's time to take a look at those lovely fluttering flags of the world. There they were, those flags of the world. If you are missing your flag on my list, then please let me know. Oh my goodness. And now the air is filling with disgusting petrol fumes.
A necessary evil, Mr. Duncan.
No, it isn't.
Because if you have to cut your grass, then you have to use a petrol lawnmower.
Oh my goodness.
Unless you get the fumes.
The smell is disgusting.
Don't worry, I'll have mine out later.
Yes, but, you know, that doesn't help us now.
Tacky asks, what's the difference between an entrepreneur and a merchant? Very good question.
Well, they're completely different words. They really don't have any similarities. So a merchant is a person who sells things, and an entrepreneur is a person who is very good at setting up businesses.
Maybe so, coming up with something new.
Yes, ideas for new businesses. So maybe they have one business, or maybe they invest their money in lots of different businesses, or maybe they create their own businesses. So an entrepreneur is a person who creates businesses. A merchant is a person who is in business, and quite often they sell things.
Yes.
That's it.
So they could have been an entrepreneur at one point, but yes, a merchant might sell lots of different things, but they're not necessarily somebody who is quite clever at coming up with new ideas to sell new things.
Yes.
Like Elon Musk. You'd say he was an entrepreneur for definite.
Yeah.
He also says sell things. I suppose you could be an entrepreneur and a merchant, but generally they would be separate.
Well, the words themselves have no relation. They're not synonyms.
No, but anyway, thanks for the question. So, Mr. Duncan, what is the theme of today?
Well, I think it may have mentioned the themes. We've been talking about things that have been stolen from you, maybe something that is a necessary evil, such as the motor car, although Steve hasn't been using his car very much over the past few months for various reasons. However, we might be going somewhere in a few weeks. As things slowly get back to normal, we might actually visit somewhere. We don't know where. We have no idea where we are going to go.
Jose says politicians are a necessary evil. Yes, that's a very good example. We have to have politicians, people to run society, but we don't like them, so, and we don't want to do the job, so they are therefore a necessary evil.
Yes, I think you can have good politicians, I suppose.
Yes, but generally politicians don't have a very good reputation.
It is true.
Because they're paid out of public money, taxes, and quite often they tend to be corrupt. They might have other businesses going on. There's a bit of a scandal going on in this country at the moment with lobbying.
Okay.
People who were lobbyists.
Okay.
It's quite a common thing in this country and in America that they're always trying to get favours from politicians, for example, to change policy so that a friend of theirs' business will do well. And a classic example is what we're going on at the moment with trying to clean up the environment with having all these wind farms. That's a classic case of a bit of corruption going on, because a lot of politicians, as it turns out, have got interests in the companies that make these wind farms, and they shouldn't do it. It shouldn't be allowed. I mean, it's unbelievable. You can't do that in business, in a lot of businesses now, but for some reason it's still allowed to go on in politics.
Well, I think actually there are things you can do that aren't illegal, and I think that's the problem. Things that might seem wrong are actually allowed to happen because they are technically not illegal. So if you lobby, it just means you are encouraging someone to do something. So you are putting a suggestion forward. But quite often, people will also say, can you please do this? But also, you know, I might do you a few favours as well. But technically, it is not illegal. But some people think it should be.
But if, for example, you're lobbying somebody in the government, a politician, and that politician has a friend who will benefit, or they will benefit directly in some way, maybe a member of their family is working for a company that will benefit from whatever this lobbying is, then it's unethical.
Yes.
You can't do it in business anymore. We've got very strict policies at work.
Okay.
For example, if the company that I work for, say they wanted a supply of computers, they wanted to buy 1,000 computers for all the employees. Well, you might work for a... Say you work for a computer company.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I wouldn't be allowed to put your name forward because that would be a conflict of interests.
Yes.
Because I would benefit, because I know you, as a result of the company buying your computers.
Yes.
But politicians get away with this all the time.
Yeah. Well, I think it also, if you have personal gain from something. So maybe something you are doing, maybe you are passing a certain type of law. However, you will also gain something from that law. So it depends. It depends what type of lobby or lobbying is taking place. So it does happen, and politics is a little bit like that. It does happen here. It also happens in the United States as well. Lobbying is a very big movement in American politics. Some people might say it's bigger there, much bigger in the United States than here in the UK.
Yes, Lewis, that is what I was referring to. You've mentioned about Mr. Cameron's lobbying. Yes, that is exactly what I was referring to.
Okay.
We're not going to say whether we think that's right or wrong. That's not for us to judge. We're just talking about what is currently happening. You may or may not agree with it. You might think it's necessary.
Yes.
A necessary evil.
Yes. Maybe you have to turn those the cogs of politics and industry. Sometimes they can become very interwoven. They can become very connected to each other. I think so. It can be a very sketchy practice, says Paulo Nidek. Yes, I like that. Sketchy. It's a great word, by the way. If something is sketchy, it means that it is uncertain. So maybe something might appear to be illegal or wrong, but it is still allowed. So yes, that can happen. Definitely, it happens a lot in politics.
Good,
I think,
question
so.
Here from Intelligent. What does cutting corners mean?
Oh, well, if you cut corners, it means you do things in the easiest way, but not necessarily the best way. So maybe if you cut corners, you are doing something quickly or maybe cheaply, but it might eventually prove to be dangerous.
Yes, so, like for example, if you're a builder and you don't follow all the regulations on the safety regulations about how a building is supposed to be built, maybe you don't dig the foundations down deep enough, maybe you don't make the walls thick enough, or you don't put the correct fireproofing materials in the building, but when it's finished, it looks perfectly all right. And this happens in a lot of countries around the world. And as we've discovered, it also happens in this country, because we've had some very severe and deadly fires in high-rise buildings because corners were cut when they put the cladding on the outside of the building and they didn't fit fireproof cladding.
Yes.
So it just means that you... You don't take all the steps that are necessary. Sometimes you can cut corners and it's not a safety issue. It just saves time. But if you're putting up buildings or something that could affect people's safety, then it could be very serious.
Cutting corners. I like that one. Oh, by the way, for those who are wondering, we do have the sentence game coming up a little bit later on as well. Also, here's an interesting word, Steve. Now I love this phrase, and it's one that I'm going to quickly mention because I heard it mentioned last week on the TV, and I thought, that is a very interesting phrase. To be shirty with someone. I love that. to be shirty. So if a person is shirty, what does it mean? To be shirty with someone is to show your unhappiness or discontentment through your behavior. So you are showing your annoyance towards someone. You might ignore someone or respond to them in a rude way. A shirty person is showing their disdain through their actions. To be annoyed with someone because of their bad behavior might cause the person affected to become shirty. The action can be referred to being shirty. So if you are being shirty, you are acting in an annoyed way towards someone. You might say, why are you being so shirty with me today? If someone is acting annoyed towards you, are you ever shirty, Mr. Steve?
I'm always shirty with people because it's a sort of form of passive-aggressive sort of behaviour, isn't it?
Yes.
You don't want to tell somebody's annoyed you. For example, a neighbour with a noisy lawnmower. And next time you see them, you might sort of, hello, yes, all right, yeah,
well,
I'm fine.
You act in an annoyed way.
Yes, that's it. You're the way that you talk to them. It isn't. You don't smile. You don't approach them in the normal way you do. So they immediately think that, what have I done wrong? You're being shirty with them, but it's a form of passive aggressive sort of. You know, you're not being direct with them about something. You're trying to avoid conflict.
Yes, but you are sending a message.
Yes.
A clear message by your behaviour.
Yes.
That you are annoyed at that person.
You don't want conflict. You just want to let them know that they've annoyed you. Very good word to put up, Mr. Duncan, based on what's been happening this afternoon.
Yes.
Vis-a-vis the noise.
I might be getting a little shirty with my neighbour.
Yes.
We will see what happens.
But of course, you're never going to say why.
No.
You're going to let them suffer by making them think, you know, for the rest of the night, oh, what have I done? Have I upset them? What have I done? Of course, you're always shirty with me on the live stream, Mr. Duncan.
I'm not shirty. Now, when you are presenting a show or a program, you have to have a certain amount of time for doing things in, you see. So because now it's 16 minutes past three, in my mind, I'm now thinking of when shall we do the sentence game and things like that. But right now, would you like to see something lovely and cute? No, I'm not talking about Mr. Steve. Here we go. Something that is lovely, something that is nice, something that will make you go, ah. Oh, look. Some little lambs.
It's a little lamb, Mr. Duncan.
There are many lambs at the moment around this area, and there you can see one of the little lambs. In fact, there are lots of lambs in this particular field, as you will see in a moment. Aren't they gorgeous? So this is something that I filmed last week. And now there are many lambs running around in the field. And this one is very close to where we live. Unfortunately, we don't have any animals at the back of the house at the moment. It's a shame, really.
Yes, but I'm sure I think it's because it's been much colder than usual for the time of year. And the grass hasn't grown as much as it normally has done. Therefore, the farmer is reluctant to put his cattle into the field behind us because there isn't very much grass for his sheep or his cows to eat. But that field looks like it's done quite well, Mr. Duncan.
Yes, aren't they lovely? Look, the little lambs. Oh. Aren't they? He's having a little stretch. Oh, isn't that good? Now, these particular lambs are only a few days old. Maybe they were born maybe a week or maybe 2 weeks, but they are very young lambs. And you might notice at the back, if you look at their tails very closely, they have something put around their tail to make the end fall off.
Yes.
So they are actually, it's called docking.
Ah.
Docking. If you dock a tail, it means you make it shorter. So if you look at the back of the lamb, you can see that their tails are actually quite strange. It looks like there is something tied around them. And what that will do, that will eventually cause the tail to fall off. And you will notice that quite often, if you look at a full-grown lamb, you will notice that its tail is very short. And that's because they are cut short. And that's how they do it. They put it around the tail of the lamb. And then, of course, it cuts the blood supply from the tail and it falls off.
I presume we don't really know why. It's possibly an infection thing. Maybe long tails can cause infections. I think what happens is that if the tails are too long, they get covered in feces.
Yes, it's all the poop.
That sort of probably causes infections. We don't really know why. There must be a reason. Maybe a farmer watching can tell us.
Mm. But you dock the tail. They used to do it with cats as well. Did you know that, Steve?
I didn't. Well, no. I don't mind what people do to cats.
Well, we had a cat, and it was actually docked. Its tail was actually cut short. But you will notice, so if you look at the back of the U, you can see that the tail is completely short. And that's the reason why.
Yes, I think tails, I remember we used to have a dog, and tails are very susceptible to getting infections because they're close to the ground and they can get scratched and covered in dirt. And yeah. I think that's why they dock them, so that they don't have to treat infections in tails of their cattle and sheep. Intelligence said, thank you for the explanation about cutting the corners. Ooh. And says, this probably explains, for example, why Chernobyl melted down in the Ukraine, because possibly they cut corners with the safety features. And you hear this a lot, of course, that Bhopal was a infamous, in India. I think it was a chemical plant, and they probably cut corners with the safety there, and thousands of people were killed when poisonous gases were released. So quite often people cut corners, and the reason they do it is it's to save money, time and money. And if you can cover it up, then people try to get away with it. You'd think it wouldn't happen in this country, but it does.
Yes.
As we discovered with, what was the name of that high-rise building that burnt down in London?
Grenfell.
That's right. Somebody cut corners with the safety in that building.
That's it.
And still, years on now, nobody has been taken to account for that. Nobody's been blamed. In fact, the ridiculous thing is they've actually tried to blame the firemen for not getting there quick enough. but anyway, let's not go into that. That's very political.
You sort of have. We have the sentence game coming soon. Don't worry, I haven't forgotten about the sentence game.
Maybe those lambs are getting roasted, says Saturino. Yes, they will be. They will be.
Yes, maybe some of those lambs will end up in your pie or your stew, or maybe you will have a delicious lamb shank.
Yes, I was going to say something. Yes, well, interestingly enough, We produce a lot of lamb in the UK, but I think the majority or the most of our lamb comes from New Zealand. Certainly a lot of it does. When I was growing up, New Zealand lamb was spoken about a lot. It was advertised on the television. I think that maybe it's at certain times of the year that we get New Zealand lamb, because they're in the Southern Hemisphere, so their lambs will be ready before ours. So maybe we get their lamb sort of around Christmas time in the winter, early spring, and then we have to wait for our lamb meat until the summer, probably, or late spring. So maybe that's why we get New Zealand lamb at certain times of the year.
But
it comes all that way from New Zealand. Anybody watching from New Zealand, Have we ever had anybody watching from New Zealand, Mr Duncan?
We have in the past. We used to have a couple of people watching in New Zealand. So, yeah, very good.
Duzika said that she's getting very sleepy counting the lambs and the sheep. Yeah.
It is a very good way of getting to sleep, though. If you have difficulty sleeping, it is a very good way of doing it. Yes. It is a beautiful day here, by the way, and we are live outside. And there it is. There is the view looking into the distance. You can see Mr. Steve's garden is looking nice. There is some beautiful pink magnolia coming out as well. Yes. Very nice. It's a lovely day today, by the way. And that's the reason why we're outside. It's all gone quiet now.
Not for long.
For a few moments.
It's not that warm. I'm glad I put my coat on. I've got three layers. I've got a t-shirt, a shirt, and a jacket. And I'm just right. If you say you're just right, it means that you're good.
Yes, comfortable.
Comfortable. Comfortable. I feel just right. I'm not too cold. I'm not too hot.
Good. We have the sentence game coming up in a few moments. I hope you are going to join in. I have made some of the sentence game easy or a little easier, and some of them are hard. So they are random words, random things, but they are all connected to our special feature that everyone loves so much.
Do they?
They do.
Oh, Saturino's making me hungry now. We're talking about lamb and roast lamb. Saturino says that a dish we call spezzatino, spezzatino with peas and lamb. Sounds nice.
Ooh.
Slow cooked lamb is very nice. Sorry if anybody is a vegetarian. I know somebody, I nearly said who they were then, who eats beef.
Okay.
But doesn't eat lamb because she says that I don't mind the cows being killed, but I can't bear a lamb to be killed and eat it.
She does know that they are still being killed.
Well, yes.
They're not saving a lamb. They're not saying, well, we were going to kill that lamb over there, but who is it? Who is it who doesn't... Is it...
A friend of mine.
Is it a friend?
Let's say a friend.
Steve's friend doesn't eat lamb, so we can save that lamb. Let that lamb go. Don't worry about it. However, there will be more cows eaten because they like beef. So somewhere, there is a little lamb running around free. However, somewhere there are lots of cows being gathered and slaughtered to keep your friend happy.
I suppose. I wonder how many people a lamb feeds. So how many people would it take to stop eating lamb for one lamb to be saved? That's an interesting question.
But I'm not even sure if it works like that.
I think it probably would. If enough people stopped eating lamb,
okay,
then the farmer wouldn't allow lambs to be born in such a high number.
Yes.
So technically you would save some lives. I don't know, how much meat comes off a lamb, do you think?
Maybe there are some lambs that are only half eaten. So the front half of the lamb is still alive and the back half has gone. So they only actually slaughter half of the lamb.
I think it would be exported somewhere, even if we didn't. Maybe we can send it back to New Zealand.
Yes.
They can have some of our lamb.
But I always find that strange when you hear vegans and vegetarians talking about that. Oh, I don't think it's right to kill lambs or cows. But I would imagine they're still being killed and they are still being slaughtered and they are still being eaten. So I think what it needs is the movement. The vegan movement would need to be vast, wouldn't it?
Oh, yes, because globally, there's a lot of meat is eaten. Mm. You could say eating meat is a necessary evil.
Yes.
Couldn't you? Even though technically you don't have to eat meat to survive.
Mm.
I mean, Hindus do very well on a vegetarian diet and have done for thousands of years. So technically you don't need meat, but you could call it a necessary evil. Because I think, if, for example, if you were an Eskimo, I think you would find it very hard to survive without eating meat.
Mm.
Because there isn't much vegetables growing.
There are not many vegetables growing in the Arctic.
So, you know, eating seals is probably your only... In fact, I've seen programmes about people living in very cold countries.
Yes.
Their diet consists virtually entirely of protein, meat.
Yeah.
Because you can't grow crops.
No.
And if you're living in a very cold country, so you have to eat meat. But of course, living here, we've got the choice because we can grow crops.
Yes.
And we can obviously farm cattle as well.
Yes. But the problem with living in the Arctic is all there is are seals. That's all there is to eat.
Yep.
Yeah. You don't have any choice, really.
That's right. You have to be carnivorous. Please, Mr. Duncan and Mr. Steve, says Fernando, save me the wool so that I can make some cloth. Well, In this country, it used to be, wool manufacture from sheep used to be a very big industry hundreds of years ago, but it isn't anymore because it's not economic for us to make wool from sheep here because it's too expensive. So we get most of it from abroad, from other countries, I do believe.
There probably are small areas where there is an industry, but not like it used to be.
It used to be that like the predominant industry, the wool industry, was it made lots of people very wealthy. It was a huge industry in this country, but now it's not economically viable to do it. So we probably get most of it from Australia and New Zealand. Or I don't know where we get our wool from. Well, we don't even manufacture many clothes here anymore, so we don't need wool to make clothes because most of our clothes are made abroad.
Yes, I think it would be fair to say that all of the clothing we are wearing now has been made not here, not in the UK, definitely not.
No.
So... Oh, yes, the female sheep is called a ewe, E-W-E, yes. So that is the mother of the lamb, for those who are wondering.
Is there a special word for a male sheep?
Not really, no.
No, there is.
No, it's just the male sheep, the sheep. So you would often, if you were a farmer, you see, you would just say the sheep for the male and the ewe for the female.
Somebody might correct us there. Somebody look it up and see if there is a name, but I've never heard that there is.
Maybe it's Mr. Sheep.
Yes, Mr. Sheep.
Mr. Sheep.
Like Mr. Duncan.
Yes. Very nice. Here we go then, Steve. We only have 29 minutes left of today's live stream.
Is that all? It's gone so quickly, Mr. Duncan.
Vitas says ram.
Yes, it could, of course, yes.
Ram, I think so. Although you don't really hear it used. You don't hear it used very often.
No, you don't, but I think you're correct.
Mm. Yes, a ram. I wonder why...
You and a ram, of course it is.
I wonder why they call them...
We should have known that, Mr. Duncan.
Why do they call them ram? I wonder why.
I don't.
Maybe because they ram their horns into your buttocks. I think so. Here we go then. It's time to play the sentence game. Are you ready to play the sentence game, Mr. Steve?
Yes, as ready as I will ever be.
And what about you? Are you ready to play the sentence game? Yes, we are playing the sentence game today because we are outside, but also we have the full studio outside because I couldn't resist doing it all outside. Don't forget, by the way, I am with you on Wednesday as well. We have started doing the English Addict Extra every Wednesday as well. Ooh, so I will be with you on Wednesday.
Here's an interesting question from Alexandra.
Mm?
Or Alessandra. What about Scottish skirts? Are they made from wool abroad? Well, probably not. Scottish dresses and certainly what are the skirts that the Scottish men wear? I can't remember what they're called now.
Kilts.
And some of the wool that is used to make thick Scottish jumpers is definitely made from wool from the Scottish islands.
Mm.
But that's a very small industry. The vast majority of the clothes that we have here are made abroad.
And I think also it would be fair to say that not many Scottish people wear kilts anymore. So they're normally worn for ceremonial purposes. So you don't, if you went to Scotland and you went around the streets in Scotland, you wouldn't see people everywhere wearing their kilts, especially on a windy day, because as we know, traditionally, they don't wear any underpants with their kilts.
Sheep, of course. If you talk about the proportion of male and female sheep, the vast majority of them are females.
Okay.
Aren't they, that are running around the field? Because it's the females that are producing the young, and the males are lambs are killed off for meat.
Yes.
So, yes, most of the sheep that are, and same with cows, really.
Yes. Sergio says all of the kilts are made in China. You might be right, actually. I think you're joking.
They're probably right.
But you might actually be right. Yes. Here we go then, Steve. We are playing the sentence game now. The sentence game is now on, and we are looking for the missing words from the sentence. They are random words. Some of them are easy and some of them are difficult. Here is the first sentence game for today. Oh,
what a three-word start off, Mr. Duncan. You something want to bring us something and something with you.
Yes.
Five letters, three letters and four letters.
Mm. So we have the letter M for mother. We have the letter H for house. And we have the letter C for cow.
First person that gets it right, I'll blow them a kiss.
Yes. So think of a four-letter word that begins with C.
That is not rude, obviously.
That is not rude, yes. You something want to bring a something and something with you. You might do it today, you see, because the sun is out, but the air is a little chilly. So there is my clue for this.
I think we may well already have an answer.
Really?
Mm.
My goodness. That fast?
Yes. Yes.
Wow. So who was first?
Well, I mean, I'm looking at Victoria here.
Okay.
I mean, it certainly fits.
Yes.
Well, Tomek, what you have said also fits, and so does Valentin. So we have a number of different suggestions.
Mm.
You obviously had one particular answer on your mind.
Okay.
If we were saying it was to do with the weather and being outside.
Yes.
Would that be closer to what you...
Pretty good, like today. About? So today you mentioned earlier, you said earlier that it seems warm, but in fact it isn't. So yes, we have quite a few correct answers coming through now. Very good.
Yes.
Very nice.
Yes, I like all the different suggestions that are coming up. But yes, think about it being outside.
Mm.
And that may give you a clue as to which of the suggestions we've had are nearest what Mr. Duncan was thinking about. Mm.
We have quite a few answers coming up now. Correct answers, even. Well done.
Pedro says he sent pictures showing his new haircut.
Okay.
Have you cut your hair off, Pedro?
I can't. I can't show them because we're in the garden. I can't access the internet, unfortunately, here because I am outside in the garden.
We'll show them next time, or maybe on Wednesday.
Wednesday, or probably next Sunday. We'll show them next Sunday. Does that sound good?
No, Pedro hasn't got long hair anymore.
Oh.
Even though his picture seems to suggest that he has. I can't get my words out today, Mr. Duncan.
I've noticed. Here we go, then. So time's up for this. And also we are in the garden with Mr. Cockerel. Hello, Mr. Cockerel. Nice to see you outside. There are actually some real cockerels around here. But that was ours. Our virtual cockerel. Virtual. Very nice. Very nice indeed. The answer to today's first sentence game is... Oh, you might... want to bring a hat and coat with you, like Mr. Steve, you see. I didn't know you were doing this, but it's interesting, you see. So you might want to bring a hat and also a coat with you, because it might be a little chilly in the garden. You can see the sun is coming round already, so we do have some lovely sunshine.
So, to Victoria... for getting that right. I said I was going to blow a kiss to the person that got it right.
Okay.
Well, got it right, but there are... That's just in terms of the context being outside. But Maura said you might want to bring a hat and a cane.
Whoa.
And, of course, a hat and a cane. If you are going out somewhere for a walk...
Mm.
You might have a walking cane, cane, which is a long stick.
Yes.
A cane.
Yes.
If it's not going to rain and it's warm, you might not need a coat. You might bring a cane instead. So well done to that. Tomek suggested that as well. But we also have Valentin saying ham and corn.
Okay.
So that does fit. So if you were going somewhere where you needed to bring food, then yes, ham and corn could be taken.
Yes, for those who are not vegetarians.
Everyone wants to see Pedro's pictures, but unfortunately Mr. Duncan is outside and doesn't have direct access to his computer.
We're in the garden, unfortunately.
So we can't stop everything to look at the photos, but Mr. Duncan will... look at them and show them on Wednesday, maybe?
Wednesday or next Sunday, when we are all here together, including you.
And I'll be very keen to see new hairstyle, because I'm jealous, because I can't have any hairstyle apart from slaphead.
Okay.
So there you go.
Interesting. Here we go, then. Here's another one, Steve.
I'm just laughing at what Alexandra... has said about Tomek. never mind.
Okay.
I'm sure it's all done in jest. But fine. Yes, next one, Mr. Duncan.
Okay, it's on the screen now.
Oh.
I am something of something.
Again, I am willing to blow a kiss to the person who gets it right first.
Yeah.
So if that is an incentive...
I hope it's Tomek.
That may or may not be an incentive for you to be first.
Yes.
Not that it's a race. Although, it is a race, really.
Yes, technically it is a race, because...
Kat again says that they're late today. Doesn't matter, you're here, that's all that's important.
Yes. Kate Gann, hello to you.
Kate Gann, yes. Nobody is interested in Pedro's haircut apart from him, says Tomek. Well, I would beg to differ.
Yes. So what has happened? Maybe Pedro has shaved all of his hair. Maybe he's become a Buddhist.
Well, I hope not. Yes. I quite like the long-haired look.
Oh, okay.
Must be a bit hot, though, in your country, I would say, having long hair. One advantage of being bald is that you stay very cool in hot weather.
Yes.
As long as you don't expose your head to the sun, in which case you risk getting skin cancer.
Yes, okay, then that's very good. So there's some good advice there. Yes. If you are bald, always wear a hat.
Always wear a hat. I've had to have various things removed because of sun damage.
What certain parts of your body, you mean?
Funny growths appearing on the top of my head.
Oh, yeah, there's one removed. Here. Look at this strange growth.
I've had to have them removed, and the doctor said to me, that's because you are going outside without a hat on.
I must. Okay, then, Steve, we have the sentence game.
Yes. Right. I must something, I am something of something.
Yes. So think of something that some people might like and some people don't like. Think of something, maybe if you are going on holiday, or maybe if you are exploring a certain place, maybe a certain type of building. You see, there is a little clue.
Buildings. Yes, well, we've got a suggestion. I think maybe the first two words are correct.
Mm.
Maybe. It all fits. Intelligent. And Vitas. Oh, yes. Intelligent has changed the last word.
Oh, yes.
Which probably is nearer to what Mr. Duncan was thinking about.
And also Tomek as well.
Within microseconds.
Okay. That's very precise.
Yes. But when they come up that quickly, one after the other, then we know that people are getting it independently right.
Hello to Ionis, or Ionis watching in Greece. Hello, Greece.
Yes, go on.
What, Steve?
No, nothing.
Okay.
There's a lovely lamb dish that is slow cooked. It's a Greek dish, and we saw it on the supermarket online shop, and I looked it up. It's a Greek dish, slow cooked lamb in something, and we're going to buy it and try it out.
Mm.
Well,
is that connected to the sentence game?
Well, somebody's from Greece. I thought I would mention it. No, Mr. Duncan isn't feeling cold.
No, I feel great. I do have the sun on me, though. If I step back, you see, I have the sunlight. So the sun is coming around at the moment.
I think we've got it, Mr. Duncan.
Yes, it looks like.
I think we've got the answers here.
Do you like my new toothbrush? This is my new toothbrush. I got this yesterday. But it's electric, you see. It's very unusual. It's got a little battery inside.
It sounds like an annoying insect.
So I've decided to try this because apparently a lot of people now use electric toothbrushes. So this is just a cheap one. It's not expensive, but it has a little battery and it lasts for about 3 months. So I've decided to do this. Because a lot of people sing now these days, they say you should have electric toothbrush. So what about you? Do you use electric toothbrush?
Oh, that's opening up a whole new discussion.
Or
only 15 minutes before the end of the show.
Or maybe the old-fashioned way, with your hand, like Mr.
Well,
Steve.
Mr. Duncan, it's all faster, move on.
Here we go then, here's the answer. Come on, Mr. Cockerel. And the answer is bing. Oh, well, that's wrong. The answer is bing.
Bing.
I must admit, I am terrified of heights. Some people don't like heights, including me. I don't like being high up, especially on something that has no support, like a cable car or something like that. Or maybe if you are in a building that's very high up and you lean out of the window, ooh, it makes you feel quite queasy.
Well, intelligent was the first with a suggestion. And eventually, actually, intelligent did get the whole thing right.
Okay.
Well, I think it was the first person to get it. Yes, it was right. So, blowing a kiss for you, intelligent. But the first suggestion was hackers.
Okay.
So, instead of heights, hackers.
Hmm.
Well, you might be terrified of hackers if you run a business and you're worried about your computer being hacked.
Yes, someone might break into your computer and steal all of your information.
Tomek was very quick as well. So well done, everybody.
Very good, very good. Here's another one there. We've got, I think we can have two more. Hello. It's a little blackbird.
I wonder if it's the same one that's been following me around every time I'm digging soil out in the garden.
We have a little blackbird hopping around.
Yes, and a pigeon. We can't show you, unfortunately.
Here we go. Here's another sentence game.
Four words.
It is very something that we will something a something before something. What could it be? It's a long one, and we have four missing words. So maybe if you want a person to give you some information within a certain period of time, what does that person do? They have to do something. If you want, I don't know, maybe you just... I nearly said the word then. It's very easy to do that, you see. It's very easy when you are explaining something to give the actual word. So I won't.
That first word, that one probably, if you get the first one, that's going to help very much with the rest. People are talking about toothbrushes and also dreams.
Oh.
At the moment.
Oh. Maybe they are dreaming about toothbrushes.
No sound, says Mosen. Oh, maybe it's about the dream, not us.
Oh, I
can
see.
Can you hear us? I hope you can.
Yes.
When somebody says no sound, I often think it means that they can't hear us. But yeah. I think it's to do with... they've retracted the message. So I think it's to do with...
The sentence game.
The dream, maybe.
Or maybe the sentence game.
Yes, do you know, dentists... Dentists always give different opinions about what is the best way to clean your teeth.
Yes.
Even within the same dental practice, I asked, I mean, they used to say when I was growing up, instead of going side to side, you should sort of brush down like that. But apparently now they think it's best to do a bit of both.
Oh, I see. So you go across a little bit and then... up and down.
Yes, they used to say going side to side was bad for your gums or something. I don't know, but I mean, you'd have to test these things over decades to find out which was the best way to clean your teeth. Well, and even then, you wouldn't really come to a conclusion.
Don't forget, Steve, we have a dentist on the live chat.
Of course.
Bella Russia,
yes. Please tell us.
But it would appear these days, yes, someone... Alessandra said, let's ask Bella Russia because she will know, you see, because she's a dentist.
Yes, so what we want to know is manual toothbrush or electric, and should you go side to side or flick down from the top of your tooth downwards? As an expert, what would you say? But the last time I went to the dentist, which was actually a long time ago, Mr. Duncan.
Yes,
I usually go every 6 months. Belarus would be very pleased to hear that, but I haven't been for a year and a half.
No.
I'm going next month, actually.
Yes.
And last time I said, nowadays, what is the, what do people think is the best way to brush your teeth? And the dentist said to me, I think it's up and down. But then the hygienist said, no, side to side. So... which is it?
Yes. And then the other debate, of course, is electric or just with your hand. So some people use electric ones like this. So that's why I've bought this. It feels funny in my hand.
Well, we've got...
Do we have any answers?
We have. Maura was first with a suggestion, which I think is correct. I would say it is correct.
Oh, okay then.
Is that right?
I think Vitas also came up with the correct answer as
well. Around the same time, yes.
Yes. And also, I think Tomek as well.
Yes. It looks like Maura was first. Maybe.
Hmm.
Putting it out there. It certainly fits. Of course, our lunchtime has passed.
Yes.
Lunchtime is sort of 1 o'clock, isn't it?
Yes, maybe midday, 1 o'clock. Some people have a late lunch, maybe 2 o'clock. So here we go then. Here's the answer to this particular sentence game. A lot of people got it right. Thank you very much and congratulations. Another 6 minutes. 6 minutes and then we will be going. And here is the answer. Oh, bing bong, ding 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 ding. It is very unlikely that we will reach a decision before lunch time. Unlikely. So something that is unlikely probably won't happen. Something that is unlikely probably won't happen. It will not occur. It is very unlikely that we will reach a decision. So when you decide something, you can say that you have reached, you have come to a decision. You have reached a decision. And of course, lunchtime, as Steve mentioned, is your midday meal. I think we've got time.
You could have had a meeting at work, and you had to decide on the type of livery that you were going to have on your advertising material for a new product.
Yes.
And somebody might say, "Oh, time's getting on. It's unlikely that we're going to reach a decision before lunchtime.
Mm.
So let's carry on the meeting after lunch."
So something you've been looking at, and then you have to make a decision. Some people like to have the decision quickly. Some people like to take their time and do it slowly when they are coming to a decision.
Pedro's going.
See you later, Pedro.
Look at your pictures.
We will look at the pictures. We can't do it outside because we don't have any way of getting to them, unfortunately. But yes, we will show them next Sunday. One more. I think we can have one more sentence game and then we are out of here. I something these something something days. Really something. Oh, what could it be? We have
12 letters.
We have a big one at the end.
12 letters on the last one.
It's a very big one.
Sora's is waiting for lunchtime. Claudia's going as well.
I am waiting for my tea cake time, which is coming soon. Isn't it, Steve?
It definitely is.
Tea cake.
Tea cake, cup of tea, and I'm going to have a banana as well.
Oh, okay. If it makes you happy.
Just because I feel like one.
Good.
No suggestions yet. One, two, three. It's a big one to end on, Mr. Duncan.
It's a very big word. 12
letters on the last word.
That is a big word beginning with I. 12 letters.
Belarusia didn't really tell us. It's lunchtime in Argentina, says Belarusia. So it's their decision to leave now.
Yes.
Well said, because that's obviously related to the last.
It is also a good decision.
Yes. Well, you could have waited another 4 minutes, but never mind.
No, if you have a choice between us and food, always choose food every time.
Belarusia says electric toothbrush is good, but it depends on how you use it.
Hmm.
Yes. Exactly. So if you use it too aggressively,
yes,
then you'll damage your gums.
Yes.
The same with manual. I think it does all depend on how... I think any way of cleaning your teeth, Belarus, you would probably agree, is good, as long as you do it and you do it regularly.
What about with a hammer? Can you clean your teeth with a hammer?
How about sandpaper?
Yes, I've done that. I actually did that a few years ago. I had a bit of a small stain on my tooth, and I actually got a piece of sandpaper, and I rubbed the sandpaper, and the stain actually disappeared. By the way, don't try that, because I don't think it works
properly.
Good
job Belarusia is gone. She'd probably have a heart attack.
Yes, I think Belarusia would be very angry to hear that. Okay, we are going in a few moments. We have this one last...
And it's proving to be quite difficult, I think, because we haven't really had any correct answers yet.
No.
Or really anything even close, I don't think.
I think this is a hard one. It's a tough one.
Oh. Oh, intelligent. I think you're onto something.
Mm.
Not sure about the last word.
Hmm.
But it's certainly getting close.
Yes.
Yes, okay. Hmm. What do you think about that sentence there, Mr. Duncan?
It's near, but there are at least two words there that are incorrect, including the last word, the big last word. I wonder what it is. Ooh, we'll find out in a moment.
Oh, yes, because the second word begins with... The third word begins with F.
Hmm. Yes, the first missing word begins with F. So maybe your experience of something.
Oh, that's right, then. These are... Hmm.
4 o'clock.
Should we give a clue? Have one of the four seasons got something to do with it?
Well, yes. Yes, I suppose these something days. So when you think of a certain time of year, you might have more time to do something. Or it might make your mood change in a positive way. That's all I can say, really, without giving the answer. Another 30 seconds, and then I will give you the answer. But it's okay if you don't know the answer. It's all right.
Is the word summer in there?
It is.
Right, so we know that. The last word is proving to be difficult for people.
I like Rosa. Rosa says insufferable. It's strange because a lot of people use that word to describe me.
Well, it's 12 letters, so it fits.
Yes. But no, this is a positive sentence.
Irresistible? You don't really describe summer as irresistible.
No, unless, of course, you can't resist going outside during that time. But it is not, no.
And summer... Well, you see, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Fernando is going for breakfast. See you later, Fernando, and have a super duper Sunday.
See, it could be insufferable if you live in a very hot country.
Mm.
So yes, I think we're more or less there.
The answer is coming up right now because it's time to go. See, boom. What was that?
Have we got a train track near us, Mr. Duncan?
I don't know what that was.
Ah.
What happened there? What was that?
I'll tell you something. We have people have come up with lots and lots of 12-letter words beginning with I.
Yes, there are
a lot. They've been very, very, very clever in coming up with all these very... long words beginning with I, you and are, they're all correct.
You are very intelligent. I'm not sure if that's 12 letters. Here we go, then. Here's the answer, Steve. Because to be honest with you, I'm hungry and thirsty, and I want my tea cake and my cup of tea, to be honest. Here it comes. Are you ready for the answer? Oh, you might be very surprised.
I don't think anyone's got the last word right.
No, here it comes. Here is the answer right now. I find these long summer days really invigorating.
Yes, invigorating.
So
invigorating.
If something is invigorating, it means it gives you energy. It makes you feel alive. It energizes you. It gives you lots of energy and enthusiasm because summer is a lovely time of year.
I can see why people thought that the second word was lazy. I find these lazy summer days. Of course, because you often describe summer as lazy summer days because it's hot, you're not doing very much. So you could put lazy in there.
Yes.
Instead of long.
Yes,
and the sentence would still work.
I think so.
But insufferable, some people have put, yes, it may be insufferable if you don't like the hot weather. So
yeah.
It might be true for you. If you live in Mexico, for example, or in the heat of the jungle somewhere, you might find hot summer days insufferable.
Invigorating. So there is a great word. Perhaps it's the first time you've ever heard that word, invigorate, to give energy, to enthusiasm. You are being energized.
Invigorated. I took a cold dive into the sea. I dived into the cold sea for a swim, and when I came out, I felt invigorated. You feel sort of full of energy, revived.
Yes.
In some way.
How would you describe a word monger? A person who can create new words is often described as a word monger. So the word monger is often refers to someone who makes things. So a word monger will be a person who creates words. Maybe they have a great skill at using words or producing words. So that's how we do that. Thank you, Jimmy. Thank you very much for your question and also for your Hong Kong dollar as well. Thank you very much. 10 Hong Kong dollars. Thank you. Very kind of you. We are going now, Steve. It's time to say goodbye. 2 hours have gone.
Very quickly and in some instances very noisily.
Yes.
But that's all gone now. I think I'll forgive the neighbours. That's all I'm going to say on the matter. I'm going to go inside, Mr Duncan. As always, I'm going to put the kettle on. I'm going to put tea bags in 2 cups.
Tea bags.
I'm going to pour the boiling water in. I'm going to brew the tea for about 5 minutes.
So if you want to know how we're spending our Sunday afternoon, we are tea bagging.
And then I will put the tea cakes in the toaster, and I will also be healthy and have a banana as well.
Okay.
Lovely to see you all, and hopefully see you all again. Same time, same place, same channel. Next week.
Next Sunday, Mr. Steve is back. Thank you, Mr. Steve. And there he goes. He's gone. Mr. Steve, he's disappeared. He's now going into the house to bring forth some well-deserved refreshment. That's all I can say. I hope you've enjoyed today's live stream. It's time to go. Thank you very much for your company. We've covered a lot of subjects today, I will be honest with you. Don't forget also Wednesday, I'm back with you on Wednesday, twice a week, English Addict Extra Wednesday. And of course, next Sunday, I will be with you as well. For those who can only join me at the weekend, I will be with you next Sunday. But don't forget, I'm also here on Wednesday from 2 p.m. UK time. Thanks for your company. See you later. I will give you a few moments to say goodbye to each other. I hope you have enjoyed today's live stream, live from the garden, because the weather these days is rather nice. Isn't that lovely? See you again soon. Take care. And until the next time we meet here on YouTube, if it's Wednesday or Sunday, take care. Stay happy. Stay safe wherever you are in the world. Keep that smile upon your face. And of course, you know what's coming next. Yes, you do. Ta-ta for now.